Hi there, Fleur de Lisa with Burlesque Palace. Today we're going to talk about burlesque. Now I'm not going to tell you about the history of burlesque or what is burlesque, but I am going to share with you a few of my experiences in the burlesque community. But first, the genesis of Burlesque Palace. I was innocently watching late night TV when I thought to myself, there must be a better way to marry story with sexuality. Then I went to my first burlesque show, and I knew that that was the door into the series that I wanted to write. I was so enthralled with burlesque that I wanted to see more and more, but I wanted to see the best of the best. So I headed down to Vegas for the International Burlesque Hall of Fame Festival, held coincidentally at the Orleans Hotel. What struck me most that first year was how much respect was given to the legends of burlesque, those gals that performed back in the heyday. I knew that I would have to somehow include the history of burlesque in the series that I was writing. That's one of the many reasons why Burlesque Palace is an anthology series, with each season focusing on a different generation of the same family. The other thing that blew me away was the diversity of the neo-burlesque community, or new generation of performers. There was gender-bending boylesque and traditional girlesque, solo performances and group performances, comedy and irony, and each was completely entertaining and so body positive. I was so inspired by burlesque that when I got home, I enrolled in burlesque classes and made my debut as Fleur de Lisa. Let me tell you, after taking my clothes off in front of an audience of strangers, everything else seems way less daunting. Last year, I headed down to Vegas again, and there was an older fellow sitting next to me at one of the shows. I asked him, "What brings you to the show?" He told me how he had been at the hotel the year before, and he had watched the girls stroll by with their dresses and hats and sparkles, and he knew he had to come back for the show. Then he shared with me a story from his youth. He and his buddies were on a road trip down to Florida when they stopped in, you guessed it, New Orleans. They were walking down the street when a barker used his cane to lure them into a burlesque house. But after a night of overpriced drinking and watching burlesque, they left with no money in their pockets and they had to head straight home. You'll meet this barker and his cane in the opening scenes of the pilot for Burlesque Palace. Burlesque Palace uses cameos from the neo-burlesque community. It draws upon the creativity and the pageantry, and it also aligns with an already established burlesque fan base. The world of burlesque lends itself to impossibly possible, larger-than-life characters, but I've made sure that the world of burlesque serves the story, not the story serving the world of burlesque. So why did legendary burlesque die when there were so many captivating performers such as Dixie Evans, Zorita, and, my personal favorite, Lily St. Cyr? There were many reasons, but the sexual revolution was one of the big ones. Blue laws changed and boundaries were being pushed. A dancer in San Francisco started by dancing topless, without pasties, and before you knew it, strippers were taking it all off. And then there was the television. Television increased in popularity, but theater decreased. Wouldn't it be great to use television to introduce burlesque to a whole new audience? It would be a full circle moment. Tomorrow, I answer the question, why am I the perfect person to tell this story? Bye for now.